Welcome back, Nitty Gritty. We are here with the skin boss, Lisa Richards.
Hey.
Lisa, thanks for putting up with us. She's just been sitting to Cam and I talk for like the last 20 minutes.
Fully entertained.
We went down a lot of roads, too.
Like quickly happened.
I mean, we went all the way from...
to skincare.
Skincare, GameStop, stocks.
Trump,
UFC.
COVID.
Same-sex COVID. Marriage.
All of it. We hit it all.
Vaccine. Uh-huh. Vaccinations.
Are we going to get censored?
And the new variant that
I think we just
I
got
swear
censored.
Is a marketing
you just
ploy.
Named all the check. You checked all the boxes.
Do you think Delta paid millions to name the new strain of COVID?
Ooh.
Watch them like go out of business now.
Yeah, it could be. But they're just like, we want to get our names in people's mouths.
Yeah.
So we're going to sponsor the new strain. That the government is using to get the rest of us vaccinated.
And welcome back to Nitty Gritty.
There welcome we back, everyone. Controversy, skincare, and fun. That's what we're known for. These are all jokes, people, so relax.
Oh, thank you so messages. Much for putting up with us.
Uh-huh.
I'm excited. So we were introduced. Well, Susan was the one. I was at lunch there. She's like, you have got to talk to Lisa. Get her in here. So
I think we need to just start telling... Like if a guest isn't from Susan.
Yeah, I was going to say there's kind of
that's when we mentioned. Like we have like three, we'll call them feeders or feeder guests.
Call them influencers. They love it.
Yeah.
Yes.
Susan loves being the influence, the biggest influencer. Oh, she's going to get so mad when she hears this. But what like Betsy, Susan.
Anna.
Those are probably our three biggest.
Yep.
Just say, give me your contact.
Referrals.
List.
Yep. Exactly what happened.
Mint Arrow threw down last week, though, with some names.
Yeah,
so
awesome.
she could be a new feeder relationship.
Yep.
So anyway.
So Lisa, I want to learn a little bit about you before we kind of jump into business.
Yeah.
So
you have great style, by the way.
Thank you.
That shirt is amazing.
Thank you.
Wow. I wish I had
we like
that
comfort.
In my size.
We like.
But you like color. It's good.
I do. I yeah.
So where are you from? Like, where'd you grow up? What's your family situation?
I'm from Utah County. Like, you know, I was born in California, but it's not really like I'm all Utah.
Okay. How long did you live in California? I want
2 years.
Oh, that's it.
You know, like my older siblings live there, but yeah, I don't like have memories of it.
You don't have like a SoCal sticker on your car?
No, I don't like say I'm from LA. Like,
I still say I was born there, but I was there till I was 14. So That's
very different.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, you grew up
but
there.
I wouldn't move back. Like, I well, still
you
am
like,
from
what,
Utah.
Like, one-fifth of your life?
You're an ass. Such a dick. Very influential years, Andrew, okay? I had a lot of firsts in California. First Playboy, in the dumpster at Edison High School during a Pop Warner game.
That was
first kiss.
That was the first one you went to,
fourth
huh?
grade. Anyway, I'll stop there.
Sorry.
So, good. So, yeah, I'm from Pleasant Grove. Like, I probably followed the first, like, the beginning of my life as anyone in Utah County does. I don't know. It's like I, you know, from Pleasant Grove, I went to BYU, met my husband actually before I got to BYU. So I followed a totally different path of I said, I'm not going to get married till I'm older. I'm not going to do this. First date with my husband, I said, just so you know, I'm going to go on a mission when I turn 21 and I don't date exclusively and this and this. Well, we're engaged 6 weeks later. I got married the same year I graduated high school. So
did you really?
Yeah, I was 18 and everyone thought I was joking when I said I was getting married because they were like, not you, because I was not the girl.
You're like not anti.
I was not a lovesick boyfriend type of girl. I was just like, see ya.
Still married to the same guy?
Yeah, 20 years.
Oh my god.
Almost 21.
So how do you do it?
It's like Betsy and Jennifer.
I was just like, that's when I really said, I was like, why couldn't you come around 5 years later?
You did miss
because
out
I was
on a
like,
lot of
oh
fun.
Crap. I said, if I don't marry him, someone else will. Like this
like FOMO.
Opportunity. Yeah, this opportunity will pass me up. So I was like,
he must have been pretty good.
He's pretty darn good. So that's why I was like,
and you still think that
amazing. Like that's I say he's like my best kept secret. I can't tell people like how good he is, or I feel like I'm like
might have some
drawing a standard that's a little too high. Like no, like you can't compare your husband to mine. Like yeah, he's just
that's
like,
amazing.
I said I feel.
I don't know if those words have ever come out of my wife's mouth.
That's when people are like,
but I probably don't deserve that, is what I'm saying. Like, it's not like it's her fault, but I just, it's inspiring that people.
No, every person who hears
today's
that is
going to be fun.
They're for sure going to roll their eyes and be like, I'm sure. But I'm like, no. Like, it's.
I feel like girls don't lie about that stuff, though. I think maybe guys do, but I think if a woman says that publicly, it's legit.
There's a downside to it.
Right.
There's a downside. Both of our families, everyone feels like both sides, his side, mine, feels like I'm lucky to have him. That's like, I was like,
wait.
How do you win on both sides? Like, everyone tells me like how
really?
Lucky I am. Yeah.
See, that's what I get.
And then when we meet people, they're like, we were at this one gathering when we first moved in our first house.
Him?
Yeah. Someone's like, they're like, they told them, we are so glad you moved to our neighborhood. Then they come to me, they're like, aren't you lucky to have him? I'm like, what? So I always am like the one in the shadow of like, come on.
Does he have like an 8-pack or something?
No.
It's not like that. It's on the inside?
100% personality. Oh. He's like the most out there. He is a unique person. He's the most out there friendly guy you'll ever meet. Like, do you know another man who has an above the ground pool, dyes his beard, and gets a custom sequin tail made to be a merman for Halloween?
Oh, wow.
Like,
I feel like Seth would
do that. It's very obscure.
That's amazing.
So
a custom made merman.
Sequin, custom tail to be a merman.
It's merman.
Yeah. He was King Triton. He has dark hair. We bleached his beard 4 times to get a white beard. Now his beard does not grow back as thick.
Oh,
so gosh. To go with his white wig, and we had
you went all out.
Yes, yeah.
So how did you meet in high school? Like, was he?
No, he was already 21, okay. And I was working somewhere in high school. Like,
wait, in high school? Were you?
Well,
17?
I was 7. I met him technically in high school. I was working in Riverwoods.
Statute of limitations.
Yeah,
you're good.
And then I was just like,
time.
Hey,
he was a super senior. Like,
yeah, we didn't have cell phones yet. No, he was just like he was coming to visit a friend in this store I worked at.
Got it.
And so we didn't have cell phones. So I was like, track him down. Like, hey, I want to go out with him. And then we went out every single day.
Wow.
Like, after the first day, he said, I'd love to do this again. I said, well, that's great. I'll leave it up to you. And he's like, how about tomorrow? I'm like, okay.
Wow.
So
married after 6 weeks or engaged?
Engaged
after 6 weeks.
Engaged after 6 weeks. Okay. Married like 3 months later.
Wow.
Do you have a personal Instagram or just your skin boss?
I do. Look up him. He's Abe Richards. If you find him, he's public. If you look him up, you're going to be totally, I would say, when you look him up, you'll be totally confused. Like, what is going on? That's, it's just confusing.
Look at his sailor.
Yes.
The sailor outfit.
He gave the sailor outfit. Yeah, he wore it to my sister's wedding because she said, wear navy. So he wore sailor. So, and then we were on a boat in Puerto Vallarta and he gave it to the captain and said, you are the true captain, and took it off and gave it and bequeathed it to him. That was Christmas.
Brett.
Yeah,
I'm telling you.
That's Christmas.
Is that your dog?
No, that's my sister's dog.
He rented it for the photo shoot.
So he hoiled amazing. The dog so he could do hashtag dogs of Instagram.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
We should have had him on, too.
Yeah.
Bring them both.
You're so lucky to have him.
He's wearing gold watches, by the way.
One of them's mine. It's like a fake Cartier.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah, it's the details, you know?
How fun. I better
so. Wow. Anyways,
so you get married and then still decide to go to BYU.
Yeah, so I'm at BYU, but then, you know, I'm already married and going, okay. So anyways, I was doing great at BYU. I love BYU. We were both there, but then I was having a hard time choosing my major. And then a couple years in, I was like, it sounded so dumb, but I was like, I wish there was a major in beauty. And I was like, that sounds dumb. I don't want to go to beauty school, but I was like, I wish I could really like dive in and have a fuller education on the science of everything with that. Like, I just want to learn it better.
Where did that come from?
I don't know.
Like, were you like,
I just
at
love
a young
learning.
Age, did you love like beauty and that kind of stuff?
Not more than the average girl. But so then I just thought as a side thing, I was like, I want to be a makeup artist, like for a job. How do you get licensed to do that? People are like, well, you can be an esthetician or go to hair school. And I was like, ooh, what's an esthetician? They're like, skin. I'm like, cool, let's do that. So I deferred one semester at BYU. I was like, I'm going to come back. I'm going to go do this thing. So I did that and had no idea like what it was going to be in the future.
Okay.
So I was just serious, like, I hope I make my money back from this.
Yeah.
And so like the investment in esthetician school, but then that's what like flipped a switch of like, I love ingredient technology and I love all this. And so I just kind of became like
ingredient technology. What is ingredient technology?
So when you look at a product, like understanding, like instead of an ingredient list, what like that's a whole realm of like the technology of ingredients. Like, For example, peptides. People can, that's very general. That means they're cell communicators. So how do we get an ingredient that can speak, that can deliver in the right place in the skin and speak to the cells to stimulate certain processes? Like, that's what's fascinating. That's one example.
Wow.
So I love all of
that.
So
this isn't like proactive. This is way beyond that.
No. But see, in like perspective, when I got to esthetician school, I was like, are there, I thought like Neutrogena was fancy skincare. Had no idea of that door you walk through. Then you're like, oh, like there's a whole other realm that I refer to as professional skincare, which is, there's no way to qualify that, but like the type of skincare professionals use like clinically.
You can't buy it at Walgreens.
Correct. That's OTC.
Yeah, over the counter. That's what that means. Just in case you were wondering.
You're so smart.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that. I want to know where that door is though.
Yeah. I just didn't know there was really.
I started
like,
putting some stuff on my face. But it's Neutrogena.
Wait, what? Like, what do you put? What do you put on your face? That I'm curious about that.
Gosh, it's like a lotion. Hold on, I'll look.
Okay,
it up.
So here's the thing: mostly males, but every person, they'll think they're not into skincare. But like, don't you do something every day? Like, even if you're washing your face with your bar soap in the shower,
wash my face every day.
Yeah, with something.
Yeah.
So like, everyone has to do something.
Sure.
It's just like, to what level do you want to do it better? You know, like.
So like why did it click? Like, had you always been like curious about like science? Because it's
no,
you're kind of like a scientist.
I don't know. I feel like I hate to like overqualify myself there, but I
should we call you Dr. Lisa Richards?
Oh yeah, that would be safe. Oh, you use Hydro Boost? That has more glycerin than hyaluronic acid. Actually,
I was wondering about
so
that.
So it's as much as it touts hyaluronic acid, it's minimal amount of that. It's not a bad product though. Glycerin is a hydrator; it keeps things at the surface.
Like that's the thing. I feel like it. I just put it like after I wash my face, mm-hmm. I use like, I don't even know what the face wash. It just gets like, you can really, it feels like dish soap actually.
Oh.
Like it takes all the grease off your face because I cook, right?
And yeah, so. Yeah, yeah. You want a deep clean.
Like, that's the thing is when I get out of the shower, like my face is super dry.
Yeah.
So I got that just to throw on after I wash my face.
Yeah, because you're stripping your skin by washing it
right.
The way you're doing it. So then you're like needing moisture when you're actually.
Exactly.
Yeah. She just said you're doing it wrong.
Well, I know.
But that's okay. That's okay.
But see,
I'm not
I
here
think,
to judge.
No. I think there are
we're
more dudes
shame.
That want to know how to do this than we think.
Oh, for sure.
But the problem with dudes is it's just got to be like,
easy.
Tell me how to do it. Where do I buy it? All in one box.
Yeah.
And it's just like maybe two or three things, yep. Like super easy. Like there's this guy I follow on Instagram who's one of my favorite hockey players, but he's way into his skin. Like,
yes.
His name's Sean Avery. He was just, and what's funny is he was like a total badass, like uh-huh. Fought every game. But he has all these like rollers.
He does.
Like fancy
yes.
Stuff. And he's trying to make it so dudes can
he's
like
making it acceptable.
Yes,
cool.
Like one cool like masculine box with like three
wait,
main
is he
products.
Selling it?
Well, he's collaborating with
okay.
One of these companies that he's been working with forever.
Okay.
And making like a men's
okay.
Like, convenience.
I can see right
like
through that
line.
One.
See what I mean? Like
yeah, but that was like yes, he's into skincare, but it was like how can we monetize something you love
yes.
With the practice?
But I think he actually cares. I think he's doing it in a way where dudes that will actually try it.
Yeah.
Because he
I'm
has like
that.
All sorts of stuff.
Yeah.
But it's true. Like I would totally do that, especially at this age where you start seeing like mm-hmm. Some wrinkles and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. It's like, yeah, you start caring about it. But
yeah.
I think it's an untapped market. I think more men want to do that stuff.
100%.
But it can't be hard.
Yeah. That's what. And you can't, I also don't pull all men in the same category because right. We say the majority of men want simple, they like physical, it's like a sensor, like they like scrubs more than this. They like cleansers that make them feel really clean.
Right.
And then you have some that, a smaller percentage who are like all in, like, I want to go like higher level here. And we're like, we got you. So,
got you.
I want but higher see, level,
but
in
that's the
middle.
Thing, even though we're kind of like, we can operate high level. We genuinely, I operate in this way of it's whatever you want. This is to serve your needs. So like, it's not here. Come with me. I'm going to put you into a 5-step routine. It's what are you willing to do? What do you want out of it? And I'll build that for you.
I'm working around that.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah. It's whatever your goals are. But if someone's like, look, I want to look 10 years younger, this and this, but I need 2 steps. Not going to happen. Like,
right.
It's like saying, I want a 6-pack, but I'm willing to
I'm not
like,
going to go to the gym.
Yeah. I don't want to work out at all. and I'm not going to die. It's like, well, let's align those. Like, yeah. So we just say we align
then
your goals.
Then you hand them Neutrogena, yeah. And say, here you go.
Hydro Boost.
Hydro Boost.
It's Neutrogena, full of glycerin.
That's not a bad ingredient. That's a good ingredient.
Not?
It's a good ingredient in skincare. It's just that it's like a simpler, like, it's like, think of it as a gel that stays at the surface. Glycerin prevents things from getting lower into the skin. But they make it sound like it's all hyaluronic acid, which is a big super humectant, but it's very little of that.
Did you get that?
Yeah. Humectant. Obviously, I learned that in algebra.
Humectant.
And science. And water. My senior year of high school.
When did you realize you were good at this? Because the way you're talking about it, you've been doing it for a while, but
She's passionate about it.
But you're good at it, though.
Okay. Yeah, so I am passionate about it, which that term always gets like, ugh, because everyone in my industry tells you they're passionate. I'm like, qualify it. Like,
but if you're really passionate, you'll learn. Like,
yeah,
you know, if you're really passionate, you're gonna like go down the wormhole, right?
Yeah, that's the difference. I think it wasn't that I was like, oh my gosh, this is my calling in life. It's like whatever I do, I'm an obsessive personality. So when I love to learn, so whatever I'm going into, I go nuts. So the other things like hobbies and interests in my life, nothing's mild. Like I'm all in, you know, like
I'm going to say it. What? We might have another one with the superpower.
Yep.
Just saying. We'll talk about it later.
Okay.
So, hyaluronic acid. Let's just keep going. I want to learn more about
with
that.
The peptides.
So
humectants.
It just sounds like cocky to be like, when did I know I was like good at it.
Skin
I don't
boss.
Know. I just like from the beginning, like even when I was in esthetician school, when everyone would kind of like want to chill, I'm like, no, I want to use this time and really like get the most out of it. So I would like go in a room and get pamphlet. Like, okay, you know the scene in Elf when he's standing in front of the door and goes, thank you, and like grabs all the pamphlets? That was me at the first esthetician conference. It was pre-digital age. I went to every booth and I took everyone's pamphlets and went, thank you. And I went home with a stack of pamphlets because I was going to make a binder so I could study everyone's literature.
That's amazing.
Oh my God.
Because we didn't have like...
Congratulations.
Yeah.
You did it.
Yeah.
World's best cup of coffee.
Exactly. Yeah.
That's hilarious.
So out of school, what did you do then? Did you jump like right into it?
Yeah, so I thought, I'm going to go back to BYU, but I actually went back to BYU part-time, and then there was a new salon opening.
How long is esthetician school?
Full-time for a master's license, it's like 8 months.
Okay.
So it's not
So you took like a full year off then?
Yeah, well, I took a semester off and then did it through the summer. So I took like winter semester off and then went through the summer and finished
you're
in
hardcore.
August.
It's like, yeah, I'm
so,
going to get this done.
Yeah, so I finished in August, and then there was a new salon opening in Provo, and I was like, so I just called like the owner essentially. I got a little bold and I was like, hey, do you need an esthetician? I am an esthetician. I'd like to do this. And so I said I'd like to work part-time. And then when I got in there, they're like, well, if you want to be full-time, you can be the only one. So I was like, okay. And so I sat on my butt to build a clientele. I was lucky because I was married that I wasn't like paying rent on my own.
Yeah.
So it was like a salon of 16 hairdressers and just me with a room to do aesthetics. And I sat there all day, every day, no clients. And I waited and talked to people and build one at a time. But when I talk skin, no one believed me because they're like, well, you're young, so your skin's good. And I'm like, just wait, I'm going to get older one day. And I'm going to show you all.
You do have awesome
so,
skin.
Well, thank you. I mean, I better.
I showed a picture to my wife and daughter. Like, oh, I'd listen to her. Look at that skin.
Sweet.
It's like me with barbecue. Like,
yeah.
This is what you want to see, right? Look like I know what I'm doing.
You're not wrong.
I'm not wrong. Yeah. Absolutely. I know it's awkward because I'm calling myself fat, but it's okay.
No, you're calling
yourself. There's a lot of muscle under here.
Good shit.
I promise. Okay, so I don't want to like veer too
Take
hard.
Take it wherever you want.
But I really am interested. Like, could you narrow it down to like, what's the one main mistake that most people
make in skincare?
Yes. What's like the most common thing that you see?
To say one, okay. So truthfully, the number one mistake is most people don't exfoliate or they do it wrong.
Interesting.
Because either they don't know what that means
I've heard the word before.
They do too much or not enough. But it's the number one neglected piece of
flossing of skincare.
Yeah. Well, it's an essential.
Flossing. Yeah. Yeah.
I think it's an essential part of skincare.
Right.
That most people don't realize because they say it's like if you come to the basics, what do? I cleanse and I put lotion on it. That's it.
So I just barely said
the number one most important thing you do for your skin is sunscreen. No one likes to hear that because it's not sexy, but it's like the undisputable truth is sunscreen.
So that's the most important thing you can do.
Most important thing you can do. Like anything, whatever is your hydro boost to your Botox. One step forward, don't wear sunscreen. 10 steps back. Like you cannot restore to the level of what that does.
Interesting.
Are all sunscreens created equal?
No, but it's actually less important. Like wearing sunscreen is more important than the type of sunscreen.
Okay.
Like people get really a lot of dispute over very tiny details on sunscreen, and there are a lot of details in them. Right. But wearing it, doesn't matter what kind, is better than not wearing it.
That's interesting. Really, really.
It's kind of like investing. The most important thing about investing is investing.
Mm-hmm.
The second most important thing is what you invest in. You know,
that's true.
And so it's like the same idea.
Yeah, yeah. So people can talk about quality of sunscreens and all that, but we always say the perfect sunscreen for you is the one you'll wear. So, and the 40% of people don't wear sunscreen because they don't like the feel of it. So that's when we get into, you know, there can be the things that makes a formula better or less.
Lotion, spray, still kind of the same thing.
Yeah. I mean, that's where we start getting into the fine line.
I heard the
sprays.
Lotion is way better.
Lotions are generally better because like coverage is important. So also like statistically, most people wear a quarter of the recommended dose. So like for your face, you should have like a teaspoon, and most people just do a tiny bit and try and spread it, but they need a lot more. So when you're seeing like the SPF and how much they should be putting on. Right. But see, it's all
about
like
tablespoons.
It's subjective to like the size of the person and the all sorts of things. Yeah. Like, are you putting it in your beard? No. Like,
right.
Does the SPF matter?
SPF, that refers to the time frame that your skin is protected. So it does in terms of how often you reapply. Like,
wait, that's true?
Yeah.
Like, so SPF 50 means it'll work for 50 minutes?
Nope. So it's an equation, so that's what they should change because
skin protection formula, right? Isn't that what it's called?
Sun protection factor.
Sun protection factor. Not even close.
Did you just make that up?
Well, my son asked me the other day, he's like, what does SPF stand for? And I made it up.
Yeah, sun protection factor. It's an equation. It's called MED, which is, I won't even go there. Sorry. I have such a hard time like pulling.
But I am kind of interested. Like, I just thought it meant it was stronger, like better at blocking the sun. Yeah, you're saying
So yes, but do you know, so like SPF 30 is not double a 15. It is in a reverse equation. So a 15 blocks 93% of the UV rays.
Mm-hmm.
And a 30 blocks like 95%. So most people are like, it's like hardly doubling. Any difference. Yeah. And a 50 is like 97%. So it's not doubling, but the reverse is, so you're still letting in 6%. But if you double to a 30, you've only let in 3%. Okay. Like those don't sound, right. That's not mathematical.
But see, I've heard 30 is like the true max. Like
30 is not the true max. It's where you should be. 30 is like the standard. 15 is like, we don't do that.
Like anymore. I heard 50 is no better than 30, but is that not true?
Not really. Like if someone's prone to a history of skin cancer, prone to hyperpigmentation, like spots on their face, if that's a concern, they have to be more vigilant. So that's when we put them in a 50. But like 100, it's not totally necessary after you get above 50.
I had no idea. Yeah. So much learning. I'm sorry, I went off the time. You know, we were going down. What's that called?
Timeline.
Oh. So we're out of school.
Yeah.
We'll circle back. Sorry.
Here we go.
ADHD. Here we go.
So I was like building clientele. Took me a long time. Talked to everybody. Hustled. You know.
So you're getting clients who are coming in to do their hair.
Kind of. I mean, some people would call in. So the reality is I wasn't doing a ton of skin right off the bat. Like I learned a lot of skin, but people come in like, does someone here to wax my eyebrows? And so that's what I would wax their eyebrows. But then I'd talk to everyone about skin, or then they'd bring up skin. And, you know, so I slowly started building people into that. But yet we have more treatment options. I mean, there's so much more available now. I've been doing this almost for 20 years. Right. So it's about 19 now. So we have so much more available than I did at that time. Like the kind of machines we have, the products we have, all that. Like, so I was somewhat limited to compared to what I can do now.
So like, what was the most popular thing you were doing for skin back then?
Besides facials, microdermabrasion, which I'm not a fan of anymore. Like I still have that machine, but to me it's obsolete.
Okay.
So
why?
there's a number of contraindications. Like, you wouldn't do it on acneic skin. You wouldn't do it on skin prone to sensitivity or redness. Like, it's the suction, the abrasion. It's just kind of rough to basically exfoliate the surface. And I think it was overhyped when they first came out with that. They came out with microdermabrasion, which is, people called it then like sandblasting your face. I won't call it that, but they're like, it will make, it's like going to overdo chemical peels. We don't need chemical peels anymore. False. Like, chemical peels work totally differently. There's like, you know, so there's, yeah. So there's just better resurfacing options now that we don't need to just.
Resurfacing options.
Sorry, that means like exfoliation, resurfacing anytime okay. you're removing.
Well, aging is like such an in thing right now, right?
Like yes.
Anti-aging.
Always.
Yeah, like I feel like I'm hearing about it more and more and more in like different podcasts I listen to and stuff. And it sounds like there's some pretty.
We're a society more concerned with it, like increasingly.
Right.
But there's like when you say anti-aging, people be like, what's the best anti-aging for this? Like, that's a umbrella that is.
Sure.
There's, like we say, the approach to anti-aging is complex, meaning you can do it in 1,000 different ways and you can't do it in just one way.
Right. See, so I was watching one of your posts, mm-hmm. like 3 or 4 back, mm-hmm. and you were talking to some like anti-aging expert.
Oh, okay. I know what you're going to say. Everyone tells me this.
What?
I kind of had bad dreams.
Okay. Like,
If you know about anti-aging, like her face, like she had so much plastic surgery.
I know.
It was almost like frightening.
Every time.
So it was really hard to listen because I'm like,
she's an industry founder, expert, icon.
Really?
Oh, yeah. She, like, celebrity, like,
I don't get,
mentor
like,
for...
Do people see that? Like, when they get it, they look in the mirror.
Everyone and sees it.
Well, no, but I'm saying, like, themselves, like, do they look in the mirror like, yes?
No, I wonder the same thing about a lot of stuff, though. But in the same way where people get way too much into fillers and injections, like, every right. girl that... The problem is you lose... your objective perspective. So every time, like girls with eyelashes, I'm gonna get hate for this. When girls get eyelashes, it becomes, their eyes are now trained to, if they take those off, they're like, my eyes feel naked. I'm like, but I've never looked at someone and thought, that girl needs lashes, you know? Like, I've never looked at someone and said, they don't have very many lashes, you know? So it's just like, once they get used to that, they think that's what they need. Yeah, she's my mentor, like long-term. She's 70. But I mean, to her, the hard part of that is because of surgery and work and stuff, you actually don't know how good she looks for her age because you see
right.
that
and
all you see is like you've had work done instead of like if you saw that she's 70 and her neck and her hands have no sign of age.
Wow.
That is like what's telling.
I gotcha.
So okay, you can't, it takes.
But, it looked like cheating
but
to me. Like,
no, but exactly yeah. to that point, that's what proves it is I'll show my husband a picture of someone I know who is 25. Has lip filler, fillers everywhere, all these things. And I say, how old do you think this person is? He's like, I don't know, a good 40? And I'm like, that's the problem. You think there's someone older who did this to try and look young. So right. when you do so much, you become ageless, but not in a positive way. You can't see the age at all to be like, you look nice for your age, or you look like, it
you're
just
right.
like,
saying
it's all you see is the work.
Makes it
yeah,
different.
All you see yeah. is the work done where you're like, okay, so whether we do lashes, lips, other filler, we just do so much where you think, like, I never look at a girl and say, like, her lips are too small, you know? Like,
yeah,
like
right?
she's so much less attractive, but yet women do it and they're like, oh my gosh, I look so much better. But then it goes, so then they feel like, oh, I need, we get into more is more.
Right. Like
so
tattoos.
Everyone does more. Yeah. And you think it's just, you're going to get more attractive the more you do. And then.
That's crazy. I don't get, because so many people are doing it now. Like, do you ever see people that get plastic surgery and just go like, I could have done things for them? To get them like pretty much
for
all
sure.
the way there without
not all the way there. You can't
surgery.
Do that, but it's right. that I feel like I could have got them to a better place and a place that is sustainable versus that. Because even when women say, I'll have an older woman say, I think I'm just going to get a facelift. And I'm like, do you know, we're no longer in a time where it's nothing to facelift. Like there's 60 steps in between that.
Right.
And the problem is when they go from nothing to facelift, like they didn't have any skincare in place. They didn't do anything. And they go to facelift. All you did, it's like, think of a home.
Like weight loss surgery.
Right. Okay. So,
I
yeah.
mean, seriously, if you don't.
You never change your right? lifestyle.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because it's the same thing. Like if you had a home with a cracking foundation and you just respackled it.
Yeah.
Like you didn't change anything below the surface. So it's going to gravitate back. And even when women do a lot of that stuff, like structurally, it's, you didn't change the underlying support system, but also superficially, it didn't take away any age spots. It didn't take away any, like, it pulled the fine lines, but their texture, like, it's a giveaway where I look at it and go, well, now your neck is super saggy. Like, which just this sounds judgmental,
super
but I'm just
tight,
saying, like,
and then just turkey yeah. gobbler. Just
yeah, blah, but now they make something for that's like, you can get injections in your neck, you do a neck lift, but it goes on and on where it's not to mean I'm against all that. It's that I wish there was more understanding that there's so much in between that. That instead of like, hey, I'm going to get like weight loss surgery of like, do you know if you made a few nutritional tweaks or you just worked out a little bit, like this could be sustainable for you.
Right.
Like in skincare, how long does it take to see results? Because use anything, right? And it's, mm-hmm. it's the habit of doing it that yeah. gets a result. Is yeah. that why people don't do it with skincare, is because it takes a long time? Or can you start to get results pretty quick?
Because it depends on the severity and it depends what you're going to do to solve it, because we just live in an instant gratification time, which yeah. is why everyone's looking for skin hacks, which is why everyone, like, people look for injections or things that are immediate. They want immediate gratification instead of doing the work. But it's the same as like the body. I make a lot of analogies to the body where the skin's a living, breathing organ. There's nothing you can do that's permanent, really. Like, it's going to evolve. So okay. in the same way, that's a good thing, because so we, just like someone can build a healthy body, we build healthy skin. So I don't often refer to like what I work in as a beauty industry as much as I say skin health, because I'm not looking to, my goal isn't I'm going to make you more attractive. It's I'm going to make your skin healthier. If that makes you more confident and you feel like, then great.
Right.
So it can be generally seen as attractive, but my goal isn't let's look hot, you know, like yeah. it's that I want to take what you're seeing on the surface that we call fine lines or discoloration or pore size. That's, I get to take that from like the more scientific part of what's happening underneath. And we want to fix that at a cellular level of how the skin is functioning. So that's the end result, but I'd like to go to the root of what's happening and solve it. So severity, like, I mean, we have all different categories from acne to sagging skin to discoloration. That discoloration, like pigmentation, that's the hardest thing to get rid of. That's a doozy because you're always prone to it. But it can take anywhere from like, we can see some results in a month, but for some people it can be 6 months. It just depends what we're battling.
So use acne as an example. Mm-hmm. Is it, to do like proper skincare, is it the cost, time, or like lack of knowledge why people turn to a proactive or other types of things to kind of get that fix?
Lack of knowledge and accessibility.
Okay.
Because like they see someone like me, like that's what we're trying to bridge, that gap between here's how we can help you. You don't have to know everything. We're gonna teach you. We're gonna assess everything. We're gonna figure it out. We're gonna show you a plan. But most people, it's like the first thing you think is let's go to the dermatologist, and they have plan A, B,
exactly,
and C.
Right.
I can tell you exactly what A, B, and C look like. C is Accutane, but there's very limited options. Nothing's personal, nothing's customized, and there's no consideration for what they were doing before and what their plan is for after. Like going on Accutane,
it's not preventative.
I'm not against right? it, but yeah, what are you going to do after Accutane?
Do any dermatologists recommend like actual skincare?
Now they've gotten more into it. They rejected it a lot in the last 10 plus years. They've gotten more into it because they see like the retail side of it and its benefits. And so most of them incorporate estheticians, or now they kind of move into a med spa category.
Just because they can make money at it.
Yeah. But also, I mean, practically it does. It's a way to continue the client's treatment yeah. and care.
Why were they against it?
They just didn't see the relevance of it. It was just like they saw it as
the drug company.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, really, right?
Yeah, cosmetic, and didn't think it would really work.
Okay.
And then now, I mean, like, there's so much information and proof that it's showing what it can do.
Interesting.
Like really good formulation. Not all skincare is
easy. So I'm curious. Like, it's like me with barbecue.
Mm-hmm.
If I go into a barbecue joint, I can pick out 10 things really fast. Like, oh. They just did this. Like when you look at us,
yeah.
Like, can you just see
judge
something
our
right?
Skin real quick.
No. Just something like right off the bat. Like, do you think like that, or like you have to be in work mode?
No, I always think like that, but it's not like harsh. Like I'm not judging people because
for sure.
people. Like a woman was in the spa today, and she was like, I was talking her through her skincare, and I don't even think about this, but she's like covers her face. She's like, oh my gosh, I'm just embarrassed that you're seeing my skin. And I'm like. No, I'm not looking at you like, oh my gosh.
That's how it is when people cook food and I'm there. They think that I'm
judging.
You know, his palate is going to be very tough to please. He's a chef. I'm like, no, I cook barbecue and I can pour Cinnamon Toast Crunch. Like, that's like, I'll go to McDonald's, be perfectly happy. Like, chill out.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's kind of
situation. I'm sympathetic to where they're at. So we understand whether it's people's, what they want to invest in, their time, their budget, whatever. Right. We're a little more on the like higher end of things, but it's, I'm not like, there's only one way and I can't believe you haven't been doing this. So I told her like, you've got these three items today and one of them sunscreen. Like, this is three wins. I'm not looking at that you didn't do 10 things. Right. Like, this is positive. So take every positive and that's a win.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not, yeah, I'm
I
not.
Mean, I think the sunscreen thing is a huge, you know, I just read a post that said my kids tan well, because that's me. Like, I don't get burnt. I get really dark.
Do you know what my kids look like?
Like,
it, they're very dark. And so everyone, and the irony is that my son, people will say, like, oh, he's so tan. Like, don't, do you know he wears more sunscreen than anyone else?
Just
like,
think, sunscreen doesn't stop tanning.
Yeah, well, that's, see, they don't look like their cousins.
Oh,
like,
my god.
Like, their cousins are all towheads and...
That's Woodward skin on the left, the family we married into.
So, yeah. So
see, my kids have the pasty white. Two of them have, like, closer to my skin where they get really tan, yeah, don't really burn.
They're all dark.
Yeah, wow.
So they're all, like, tan.
But you said damaged DNA, like, all you see is damaged DNA.
Yeah, well, because people say they equate, if they're not burning,
right,
that it's, like, good. Or, I mean, the things you hear around the pool and stuff, like... Are you serious? Like,
just because you're not burning,
so everyone goes, "Oh,
you can handle
yeah."
It better.
Do they have sunscreen? No, my kids tan well. I'm like, the tan is evidence. That's how your body's saying we just had DNA damage and we're trying to protect ourselves.
Interesting.
That's how melanin functions.
Whoa,
it's a defense mechanism. Like, yeah, the sun hits the surface and your body goes, "Oh my gosh, we're in danger. Produce melanin." So this enzyme gets activated, transfers melanin, puts it into, like, we call it the keratinocyte, which is like a vehicle. Think of it as the delivery truck. Goes to the surface and tans it to go, protect us, protect us, protect us. And that's why I think of someone with, like, really sun-damaged skin. What does it look like?
Like leather.
Leathery.
Yeah.
Because it thickens the surface as a protection. But when you feel their skin, super thick and heavy on the surface, and underneath is like there's nothing. Whereas healthy skin's the opposite. Thin, compact epidermis, the outer layer, and underneath is like firm and meaty. So sometimes when I'm really in my element, I'll feel women's skin. I'm like, oh, I love this meaty dermis. And they're like, huh? I'm like, sorry. It's just like
stop playing with my dermis.
I know. Yeah, so it's like that's what's happening.
Stop playing with my
thick,
firm,
I never wear
meaty
green because I do. I don't burn
right
easily.
I don't burn, but I'm 5 shades lighter than I was as a teen, but I wear sunscreen every day. So you don't think about it, like neck, this, arms.
You wear it every day?
Every morning, because this is all, even though I work inside in an office, how'd you get there? You drove. Sun goes through windows. Like, so then it's, you think, well, that's only a little bit of sunscreen here and there, or sun exposure. It's cumulatively what you get every day. You don't have to get a tan, actually, you get the damage. UVA rays don't, like, you're not always going to see tan come, but.
See, that's funny. I always just thought tan was.
You don't need to worry
from
about
the
it.
Sun. It's a chemical reaction.
Yeah, exactly.
That's crazy. I had no idea.
Yeah, it's a defense mechanism. The skin functions as it's an immune function for the whole body.
Right. So, like, people always say, I wish I had your skin, but.
The truth is.
Well, it doesn't mean you can't get damage, and it doesn't mean you can't get skin cancer, because when you get a burn, you up your chances for skin cancer, right. But slow tanning still is prone to it. But, like, okay. My mom's Mexican, and she had, like, skin cancer cut out of her face this year.
Wow.
And she wasn't like, and she goes, so much for all your sunscreen. And I was like, yeah, I said, no, I said, mom,
doesn't
though, do you understand? Yeah, I said, I know you've been good at it, but do you understand this could have been created in your skin when you were 18
right.
or 20 or 11? Like, that's what we say. It's recorded in your DNA, because it is. It just
right.
comes later. It doesn't happen. Or when people say, oh, this spot came up, like, guess what? It wasn't created last month. It could have been created 10 years ago. But now that's why we start caring about the fine lines and whatever else when we're in our late 30s or 40s and so
right.
on, because now it's manifesting.
Totally right.
So
I feel so underprepared for my skin.
But
right
I mean,
now.
Better late than never.
Yep.
Just
100%.
Like everything else. Wait, so how much sunscreen do you think you go through in your house a month? If you
we have bottles of sunscreen. Everyone knows where sunscreen is. They're everywhere. And then I pack them in all the kids' sports bags because I'm yelling like, do you have your sunscreen on? They're like, gosh, mom. You know, so I chase everyone with sunscreen.
So like, how strong of sunscreen are you putting on?
30.
I'm fine if they have a 30. Sometimes it's a 50. It's whatever bottle I can throw in.
Okay.
So, I mean, my son is the other one, dark, goes to soccer practice at 5 p.m. I'm like, take your sunscreen.
Yeah, and people the UV think, rays are low. That's well, the myth, right?
Yeah, well,
I always check the UV index.
Like after index 4 is important. Or 5. UVB rays are lower, but UVA are still happening. You still get damage anytime. So
that's what I said, even if it's cloudy, right?
Mm-hmm.
Told you. Told you, Ashley.
I mean, I'm a little hypervigilant, but, you know, so yeah, I go through a lot of sunscreen. I'm
like a gallon a month?
Oh, I don't have it in gallons. Well, I'm just going through bottles.
I'm just saying
no, I don't go through a gallon a month. I don't know. We'll say like.
Does everyone wear it every day?
So the sad thing, my oldest child, no. In fact, so she'll go outside and play basketball and like I see her laying on the lawn. I'm like, what are you doing? It's like the equivalent of someone seeing their kids smoke behind a garbage can. I'm like, how could you do this to me? You know what I care about. So she's like,
that's how they rebel.
Yeah.
Like, hey, mom. I don't have sunscreen on.
And my husband won't put it on unless I'm putting it on. So I have to take it and be like, come here. And then he'll be like, I'm wearing a hat. And I said, what about your neck and ears? You know? So then I'm like, come on. So I have to put sunscreen and I just chase everyone with sunscrean. Then we're somewhere and I have it in
my
bag.
You're the crazy sunscreen lady.
Yeah, I have it in my bag all the time. So if someone will go, oh, I forgot sunscreen. I've got it. And they're like, in your bag? Huh? I know. It's like, I just own it now.
Oh, I love it.
Well, I think that's a huge lesson learned for anybody listening, right? Like that's, like you said, that's an easy first step that mm-hmm. you should just be doing right now.
Yeah. And we hear, I mean, there's always going to be backlash on that where I hear someone's like, oh, so-and-so's mom says the sun is a healer. And I'm like, is that why
it's called vitamin
trips?
D.
That's yeah.
Different.
Well, that's different too. I'm like, is that why it trips like 5 inflammatory processes? Is that why you get like fever blisters or tired after the sun? That's because you suppressed your immune system and your body's like overloaded.
So it actually getting burned actually affects your immune system.
Even when you're not burned. So like people say, oh, my kids, like, you know, when people get like cold sores or fever blisters after, that's because when you have the sun, you overloaded there's immune guard cells. And when you have all the sun exposure, they're like going to different posts. Like you made it frantic, like we've got all this area to cover. So then viruses and other things can get through the skin. Yeah, they sneak in. And same like people get tired because the skin's like overloaded from its normal job to protect the surface, and so that's why things get in that don't normally get in.
Unreal. You're like a doctor.
Well, not really.
You should. Right, you should be like,
she's Dr. Lisa.
What would be another word for MD, but for a skincare person?
Don't know.
Skin boss.
So when you go swimming,
SB.
Do your kid, like, your boys wear like one of the like the rash guards?
No. I mean, they don't like that fashionably. Right. I mean, they live it like their shirts off. They just know they're wearing sunscreen no matter what. And then when they come, if someone comes back and they have pink cheeks or something, like a little bit of sun, I'm like, what happened? They're like, I put it on. I swear. I'm like, you cannot argue this. Like, I know you didn't put on enough. Like, or I'm like, or your amount or your reapplication. Like, it's, yeah. I mean, they're lucky and then they're not. So.
Oh, wow.
Dang. Yeah, they're going to have great skin when they're older. Thanks,
I'm
mom.
I'm like preaching all the time and preaching the gospel of sunscreen. And right. Like very few people want to hear it. But I'm still just like, because I feel like at least as long as they're informed, if, you know, they don't obey, that's on them. But I'm out to just spread the word.
Wow. This is fascinating. I want to know the story too, though.
Okay.
But there's so many
questions. Like skincare questions.
Sorry, I know. I'm just.
Now, do you make your own? Do you have your own line of sunscreen?
No, specifically because sunscreen is in a drug category. So you have to go through. So I do have a skincare line, but I'm very careful about what I'm doing and why. Very good formulas, but I intentionally don't want to do sunscreen because I'm satisfied with the ones I have to offer. But yeah, it's a drug category. That's why you can see like on the back, we'll say drug facts and show the sunscreen filters. So you have to go through a totally different process with the FDA to get like cleared for that. And I was like, it's not worth it.
Wow. So when did you, where are we at the timeline?
When did you become the skin boss?
That's exactly what I was going to ask. Like,
yeah.
So you're building a clientele in the first place. You're exclusive, right? Like you're the only esthetician.
Yeah. And then, but see, then we started, like I would hire a couple here or there to fill in. Because then unbeknownst to me, I get pregnant within a year and I was like,
Abe, come on, man.
I didn't know.
He was in his merman costume. Right. One thing led to another.
Right?
You guys have to look at his Instagram. It's pretty phenomenal.
So, yeah, so I was like, oh man. So then I just like, then yeah, I stopped going to BYU once I had a baby. So then it was like all work part time. So that's what, I've never stopped working, and I take 2 or 3 weeks off after having a baby and then go back just so I could like keep it going. And, but then truthfully, like I'm not some story of like, I just made an account and I blew up and my business is crazy. Like I built a very long, like my foundation was years and years and years. So really, even though it could be like, well, she should drug her feet, I was building like a foundation of knowledge and learning and experience in the industry for like 15 years before I ever started Skin Boss. Like,
see, and that's what this is all about. Like our podcast has started for that exact reason. Cause you have so many people that it looks like overnight.
It looks like over. Yeah.
Their social media blows up for whatever reason.
Right.
But you know, just like, just like you, like
it wasn't any of that.
It's a lot of work that most people don't know about. And that's where the story is, right?
Yeah. I had this esthetician who does really well. She's like actually a nurse in Florida. And she had messaged me like, how do you do with your kids and stuff? And I was like, well, it's different. You own your business and you're doing all this and you just had a baby. Like you have little kids. I didn't start my spa until like, I was going to start it 2 years before I actually opened one. And then it hit me. I was like, my youngest is in preschool. These are my last years with him with me. And then I started crying because I had a lease to go sign and I backed out and said, I'm not going to sign it. And I started crying and I was all melodramatic and I was like quoting Les Mis and saying, my life has killed the dream I dreamed. So I was like, it's never going to happen. And then
where does that come from? Because that the whole like shame of motherhood, you know what I mean?
Oh, right.
It's crazy. It's another level.
It's a totally different experience because you don't get to go out and be like, I am the breadwinner and I am like serving my family by doing this. Like no one congratulates you. Like instead I come home, it's like, and mom was gone all day. You're like, sorry.
Well, then
you know?
Other stay-at-home moms are judging you for like,
oh.
Well, the question is like, what did you do with your kids? Selfish. It's like, you didn't ask my husband. Yeah. What did he do with the kids?
Andrew,
shut up.
You get it on every end.
We don't want people to start asking us that.
I tell my husband this all the time. Like, you don't get the like judge the question. You don't get any of that we get. I said, I have women they say, you know, the best place you should be is with your kids. I'm like, I know I did it for all these years and I bust my tail and head to games all day after and I sleep 4 hours. Like, so it's like it, not everyone knows what it looks like, but then other people are like, yeah, you should like, this is about you. I mean, it goes both ways. Like, whereas like, don't let your kids take from you. I'm like, listen, I'm going to do this how I want to do this and you do it how you want to do it. So I'm not saying someone with young kids can't go start their business. That would have been just really hard. And it doesn't mean my kids don't need me now. It's just different. You know, I have no diapers, no strollers. We're past that. And so
kids don't need it. Like we're doing the kids a disservice.
Yeah.
I would say overall right now, they're way too helicoptered, right?
Yeah. Like
we're right over them.
Always trying to put sunscreen on them.
Right.
Always trying to put sunscreen on them.
Right.
Like they need us for their fun. They need us for like, it's so like,
it's everything.
I remember growing up, like I was never at home. Like second I got home from school.
You had no tracking GPS on you.
Yeah.
And you took off and just said like, I'll be back later. Like we would go float down the canal in PG. Like no one knew what we were doing. We go, you know, like there just wasn't, I'd show up at the end of the day. Like,
yeah,
it's not the same thing. And now it's more exhausting.
And kidnappings are lower than they have ever been in history. Do you know that?
Yeah.
Like most people think that's crazy, but it's just because we see the doom and gloom on the news and in our social media or in our apps.
Interesting.
But yeah, like there's less now than there ever have been, but we don't let our kids go more than like a block away without.
Well, maybe that's why.
Maybe. But I think it's because of cameras and it's just easier.
It's harder to do that.
Right. But I mean, I got dropped off at the beach as a 9 and 10 year old for like, you know, be at the Jack in the Box at 2 p.m.
Uh-huh.
And pick you up. Like, do you imagine?
Right. It's and I feel like it's different kidnapping. Like my daughter has been scared of that her whole life. But my son said last week, he's over 200 pounds. And he goes, you know what's great? I can't get kidnapped because they can't pick me up. I was like, yeah, that's true. This is good. So he's like, feels fearless.
Kidnap proof.
Yeah. He's like, pounds. No one can pick me up.
Well, no. And I would imagine that in this culture, it'd be in this area, it would be really hard to, you know, because we have talked to so many successful female entrepreneurs.
Yeah.
A lot of which have now their husbands work for them, or the roles have reversed where the husband's staying at home. And you're right. Like, you do you.
Yeah.
Everybody else, worry about yourself.
Yeah. It's everyone's dynamic.
It's,
is different.
And it's weird. Like, and I think kids, you know, you hear, what was the term? Like key lock kids or what? Do you remember that term? Like kids that came home from school and their parents were both working. There was there's a word for it, like key latch kid or something like that, because they had the house key hidden. Yeah, like when you get home, you're fending for yourself, right?
That was me. Yeah. Well,
but and look where you are. You know what I'm saying? Like, I think that that's, I think there's a lot of benefit to not having.
I had to figure things out. No one could do it for me, and so it's like I didn't have a ride home. Get walking, girl.
Right.
You know, like no one is waiting in the carpool line for me. Like it's like
the 1-800 collect never.
1-800 Oh my gosh, I've totally forgotten about collect calls.
And did you do the trick though? Because we always say, I'd go,
coming out, come get me.
Mom, I'm at the junior high.
That's how I got to and from basketball practice.
And I got left at the junior high with the janitor only, and no one remembered me. And I was like, at the junior high.
That was always, sedate your name. Come get me.
Yeah.
I'm done.
Kids would have no clue what we're talking about right now. So, where would you say, how long until, so we've got kids, you didn't sign your first lease.
Yeah, but I mean, and that was, but that Skin Boss had started at that point. So we had a little progression. So basically I worked part time, like, and I mean, literally it's like, I'd have a baby and I'd go work 2 hour shifts so I could feed a baby, come back, feed a baby. Like,
but like, were you, like, had you started your own thing or were you just an esthetician at someone else's?
I was an esthetician
like,
somewhere else. So I was at one salon for 6.5 years.
Okay.
And then I went to where we booth rented. I rented a room for 11 years.
Okay.
And that in there, like later, that's when I kind of, so I met Susan. So I met her at a gym and people said, how did you find out about this place? I said, oh, one of my clients referred me. She goes, your clients, what do you do? And I was like, I am an esthetician. So people started asking me questions. She's like, hey, will you like, can I come see you? And I was like, I don't work today. And she was like, okay, I just had a speaking event. I'm like, okay, I could go in. But I, yeah, so she came in and then I said, what do you want
me
to-
Susan gets what Susan wants.
Right? She has a way. So I said, what do you want? What can I do for you? And she goes, I want you to be the boss of my skin.
Shut your mouth.
That was it?
That was it. So then we talked about, right? So, but she didn't think she was saying anything necessarily. She,
right.
So she goes, just you take it over. You tell me what to do. I don't want like figured out for me. So then we were talking about it. She goes, you don't like, we don't give cards anymore. You should make like a social media profile to share all this. She's like, you're good at what you do. Like you should share what you do. And I said, I've been thinking about that, but I don't want to write a blog and I don't want to, you know? And so she's like, start a profile so people know how to find you. And think of a name. So then I came back to her. I was like, there's something you said. I want to be Skin Boss, but someone had that name. And she goes, is it someone in your industry? I said, no, it's some guy and he's private. And she goes, so put a dot in the middle. And I was like, oh, Skin Dot Boss. So I was like, okay. So I do that. And then I just kind of, like my early posts are sad. They're just like, I got made fun of for never, like her friend Allison, you would use this post I had as an example of how
not to do it.
Yeah. Like I did a picture of mushrooms to show that was a source of vitamin D and you don't always need the sun. And she was like, what's with your picture of mushrooms? So I took it down. You can't find it anymore. And so I just like did my thing. So then I was like within like months, I was like, now I'm getting all these emails and people want advice. And she's like, you could start consulting. I'm like, no one's going to pay for a consult. Well, if we were to fast forward when I was finishing doing consults personally, now I hadn't done them virtually. So she's like, you could probably charge $100. So my first ones, I was charging $30 because I was like, I'm so sorry. It's just for my time. And I'd do them while my son was napping and consult with them. But it was like, what totally thrilled me was we got amazing results from me just teaching them how to do their products via email. And then fast forward like a year and I was like, my consults are $500 if you want one. And people were like, okay. And Venmo was like, okay. Like, so then.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah. So we went to that.
Hold on. People are paying just like for you to tell them what type of stuff to use. Is that what it was?
I developed a process. Yeah. Okay. There was a process of you fill out a form. Okay. I assess it. I went through every product they use. I'm writing ingredients. Like I would, that's the thing. It would take me a lot of time. Mad notes.
That's amazing.
Then I'd go through and tell them.
You don't
like,
have to explain yourself to him.
Yeah. No, I would go through and explain, hey, here's what you're doing wrong. Here's how we fix it. Here's what you use. Here's why I recommend it. And I'd like email them 3 pages of information. They'd be like, wow.
See, and you think of skincare products, like that's not like $500 is.
Yeah,
like
well,
if you're using the wrong stuff, like you're spending
we
that
charge,
much a year
now
easy.
It's not $500 because I'm not doing that part, but it's right. like it's a worthy investment because how much money do you waste just yeah. trying to like trial and error with products? Like yeah, people just right. go through. I mean, look at anyone in Target just looking at the shelves. Like you just sit there and look at it or read stuff, or you're on Sephora or wherever you go that you're like impulse buying and you waste money. And most people have just so much product that's sitting in their cabinet. And when I ask about it, they're like, I don't know what it is. I don't know how to use it. I'm like, oh my gosh. Like waste some money. You don't know what it is and you don't know how to use it. So.
So when did you start developing your own then?
My own.
Products.
Oh, that I only launched that at the beginning of this year.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And because I was really against it for a long time.
Why?
Like, because the idea of kind of how it looks, but people would say, you should have your own line. I said, not if there's something better. Like if I'm working with a product that's better. Like, you know, one lab was like, you could have better profit margins. I said, I don't care about the profit margin. I care about the formula. At the end of the day, the quality of what, like the results or lack thereof, they're going to be seen. So I care about the formula. So until I can have a superior product, like I don't want any second rate product. So it was a really interesting thing how I was able to get with the lab I did and create the products we did. And it was like, it was awesome. So I'm super happy with it. I mean, I did a limited line because I'm very intentional about what I did or didn't want. Like, it's not like I just, where you sit down and go, okay, you got to make a cleanser. You got to make a this. No, it was like, I have very specific products in how I need them to function versus like a niche of like, I have people who need this in their skincare. So I want something with this, this, and this. And so it's very specific. It's not meant to be like, it's this full line that will do everything. And I still use my other skincare line. So it just fills in the gaps.
Wow.
Do you see yourself expanding that?
Yeah, the line, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, in time. But it's like, it's a lot. That's a little bit on keep it where it is on hold. I have one custom product we're waiting on launching. And so, but it's very like, I want to be very careful about that. It's just not about like, we got to get a launch out by this date. It's very different from like merchandise that people sell and yeah. you have like, I don't have a timeline like that where people would say, did you like have a crazy launch? I'm like, no, that wasn't like my intention at all. Like it was like, I'd have the products there as we recommend. And it wasn't like, I'm going to sell out of this in 2 days. Like that. I kind of have a really different approach, even though
it was like a tool instead of,
yeah.
You know what I mean? Well, and you want to get it done right instead yeah. of launching.
Yeah.
It
and for me, it's like working, slowly building that in time and with momentum instead of like, I want to, one quick sale, you know.
It's a lot of similarities with barbecue and skincare.
Yeah. Oh.
You know what I mean? Just like you start with good product, mm-hmm. like you use the best meat possible, right? It costs more, but it's more forgiving. Like you're going to spend 15 hours cooking a brisket. Like if you spend 20 or 30 extra bucks, you bought yourself another like hour window of like not ruining it because there's just more marbling in it.
Yeah.
So it's kind of the same thing. Like you season your wood to a certain, like I want the wood to be chopped down for like 8 months, right? Just to get seasoned and dry out. Like there's just all these little things that require patience and you can't deviate or right. you will see a big, big difference. And that's the difference between a really good barbecue restaurant and a not so good one.
I love that. I've never aligned our two industries that way, but I totally see what
like
you're saying, and
but
it's
but it is, like, listening to her talk about...
You should be the meat boss.
I should be mm-hmm. the meat boss. Mm-hmm.
Instead of the meat magician, the meat boss.
I guarantee it's gone. I'm looking.
So what does your salon look like? Like, what does the business look like today?
So now when we say, like, what Skin Boss is, some people think, like, well, first they think me, but... They just think I'm an esthetician, which I am, and I still practice because that's like what really kind of lights my fire and keeps me in it and
yeah.
and thinking about it and how I want to present things. But you know, but like I'm running a business too, so sometimes like people have a hard time saying like, why can't she do it for me? And I'm like, I can't. I'm not scalable to do everybody's skin.
Yeah.
So that's why I dedicate a ton of time. Really outside of the average. So I have like a different mission and different idea of how I do skin. We're not like an average type of med spa salon. I don't do this the same. It's like, I want to produce. So I train my estheticians where we don't just go through a training. We do education every other week. I'm with them every day. I'm like pouring my soul into them so that they can have, we adopt the same ideas and practices and purposes. Just like, you're not going to make everyone's barbecue personally. Maybe, maybe not. Right. But then like someone else, you can't do every step of all of it, but like you're going to have the same quality delivered over and over and over. So,
but it takes a long time to do that. It takes a long time to train somebody to do it.
Seriously. That's been one of the harder things for me is like, you know, cause then you,
you have to be into it to stick with it. Right.
Yeah.
Cause that's, I would say for me, that's the hardest part is I have this, like, I set this up a long time ago where I if you want to learn how to do the cooking, I'm going to make you trim and season the meat for 6 months.
That's, I love that.
Like, you can't do anything else.
Yeah.
That's the worst part about cooking, but it's also just as important as actually cooking it. And so if by the end of that 6 months, they're still stoked and they're still into it, then you know this person's very
finding those people who are like really have like the true passion for it, who want to learn, who want it. Like a lot of people like the novelty of it in the beginning. It sounds fun, like to do this stuff and get it, but it wears off on them, you know,
for sure. And you don't want to waste really hard. Like, it's so much work. Like I can teach somebody how to trim and season briskets in a day or two. They're going to be really slow at it at first. But like I said, like if they still like it at the end of that, like it doesn't require too much time on my part to teach them that. And then it's just about sitting back and seeing if they're still into it. But it's hard because if you put in a lot of work into somebody and then they just like, oh, I'm good.
Oh, yeah.
That sucks.
That's all. Yeah. Or you. Yeah. That's kind of something I'm always trying to figure out is, you know, how you invest in people and how you might could lose in that time you've invested in them. And so we do that. But like, so Skin Boss is the spa and everything I'm trying to create there. And the skincare line, and then we have e-commerce, which was originally like way overshadowed the rest of it.
What type of stuff are you doing at the spa right now?
We have a lot.
Everything.
We do. Yeah, it's like pretty much do everything. So now we had just recently done, we brought in laser. So we do everything from, not really waxers. So the spa, the reason I call it the skin spa is because we're not a day spa. We don't do massages or pedicures or any of that. And technically we are a med spa, but I want to kind of break the association of what people think a med spa is only this clinical thing where we give a dang good facial. Like it's going to be relaxing and feel amazing, but
we need to go do that.
Yeah.
I was just, that's my next question was,
we should do a remote. It'd be pretty cool.
What is the, like, what is the ratio of men to women?
Definitely a small percentage of men, but that's growing. Cause I don't like, so if you come to the spa, you notice like nothing's feminine. That was super intentional. I said, first of all, I don't like the color pink. So I was like, I don't want anything pink here. This is not a ladies' boutique.
Right.
We are not selling like jewelry and things. Like this is for skin. So totally gender neutral so that when I have men come in, whether they're rough around the edges or like pretty boy in a suit, whatever kind of man who's coming, that they feel at ease and comfortable. Because before it'd be like, you always have a wife who's like, I should bring my husband. And then the husband like is like, oh, and I'm like, I want them to feel really good about coming in. And when I like when the men come in, it's like, you know, I was like, you are on top of it. So we have everyone from the teens to middle-aged men, but definitely women are the dominant.
What's like a typical routine that you're, I mean, is it something because it happens so often that you're like recommending or prescribing like a skincare routine, or is everything so different that there's not like a,
like per person? Is that like individual? Yeah.
So that's like, that's our bread and butter. That's like our specialty is customized skincare regimens, which we'll produce from a consult. So most people think a consult's just like exploratory, but our consults are $100 because we are doing a service on you. We're spending time with you. We prep before it. We recommend and we make, like we build the value in it for sure. But so your routine has, everyone has the same type of steps generally, but the idea is we're plugging and customizing. Like I could probably build 5 different routines for you that would work, but I am interested in what is the best possible routine. And then we'll amend that according to, well, I only want to do this. Or if you were to pick the top 3 products, or what if I just want to use this cleanser? Like we'll work it with what works for that client, but it's like you cleanse morning and night, you wear sunscreen in the day. We have to exfoliate. So we start with the core of absolutes. Like you've got to wear sunscreen. You know, I'm someone going and say, I want to do laser, but I'm not wearing sunscreen. Be like, nope. Like, won't do it. Like, right. Because I've got a liability with that. Like, I'm not a responsible esthetician if I just do it anyway. So even with treatments, we work a plan to progress them up to what they want to do. We don't just walk in and say, I'm microneedling you today.
Wow.
So we do everything from, yeah, we're not like big waxers. We offer it, you know, we'll have men come in for that too, but we do consults, facials, microneedling, chemical peels, dermaplaning, LED therapy, laser.
Wow.
I think that covers it. And there's a lot of variation in between that. So
what are some of the key factors that, like, when you're doing a consult, like, what are you looking at? Like, what kind of test? Is it a test or?
Well, no, the main thing.
Can you tell by looking at it?
Pinching my cheeks to see if I got good dermis?
In person.
You have awesome dermis.
Like, when they're virtual, they send pictures. But in person, that's why we have them do, we do a, like a starter treatment, this like non-acid peel. Because I want to feel their skin and look at it. Right. And we look under a magnifying lamp and analyze it. Because there's so many things I'm looking at. Like,
is it just face?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, people bring up body concerns like I have back knee or I've got eczema here, right? Like, so we can address those things, but generally it's all face.
Okay.
So we're looking for, they are checking boxes on what their concerns are. So the question is, what would you want to improve about your skin if you could? Like, what do you want to improve about your skin? Like, in all of it, like, keep going. What else? Like,
wow.
So we want to cover everything and then we identify like primary concerns. And so the main thing that I'm really seeing in a consult, like where I'm really making the difference, is what they're currently using and what I'm going to have them use. Because that's like the fun part. That's when I would do virtual consults. I would get so excited.
Because the scientist gets to kick in.
It's a game too. Because I'm like, what am I going to get? And then I look and it's like, and I've never had one where I was like stumped, like, oh, I wonder why it's like, so I'll automatically be like, I know what it is. Like, she's doing this wrong and this wrong and this wrong. Like, so I'll be like, oh, I see, you're dry because you're over exfoliating, but then you're compensating with this. But see, the rose water is doing nothing, but you didn't have this, but that vitamin C is too, like, so I can like, wow. I love piecing together what's not working.
I know what Jenna's getting for her birthday.
It's pretty cool.
So I don't know if this is a, if you can answer this question, but what does it typically cost for like an average skincare routine?
Okay, you said average. Average at the spa, I'm going to say $300.
And now is that monthly or is that just to come in once?
No, like, that's their products.
Yeah.
I mean, we have any people spend like under 200 is kind of hard unless they have some existing products we can work with.
Okay. And is that, do they have to spend that monthly?
No. So the products are going to last. There's a little variation, but they're going to last average 3 to 4 months.
Okay.
So not bad, but you know, so we prioritize it for some people. They're
so you're going to $100 a month for your skincare routine, more or less average.
Yeah. Usually get a credit card someone doesn't know about or like a separate account. We had one girl
my
yesterday.
Skincare slush fund.
She was puppy she was money. Stocking yeah. up because she's getting married next week, and she's like, "I need to get all of this, so it gives me like 3 months before I have to like show them how much I am actually buying." But let me say, here's a disclaimer to that. I'm just saying that's what happens. I have a pet peeve, and I don't know. I doubt. I am going to bet this happens less outside of Utah, but when women go, "Let me ask my husband," I get like. And I go like, I want to say, ask them what? Like, I want to say, do they ask you if they can go to golf? Do they ask you about their hat or their shoes? Or like, it drives me nuts because I hate the like, ask permission.
I have an argument.
Oh, here we go.
So here's my theory with that. Mm-hmm. I will bet you that 80% of those women are indecisive, don't want to spend the money, and they're blaming it on the husband.
That's a really good point.
I'm just saying, at
that's
least half.
Not what I was expecting you to say.
At least half.
Yeah,
I was
no,
way
no,
more
that's,
excited for it. I thought
that's
you were right.
Valid.
Because I think we all do the same. Like, if it's some like somebody knocks on the door or whatever, it's so easy to just say like,
that
"Oh, that's kind of my wife's deal." Like, you know, I'll talk to her about it. Give me your card, and she can call you back.
I play the passive wife when someone comes. I go and they ask if I want solar panels, and I just go, "My husband deals with everything with the house. I'll have to ask him." And
totally,
I shut the door.
I will bet you that that's
okay.
True.
That's good insight.
Yeah. So I guess it wasn't an argument. It was insight.
No, thank you. I
like the dramatic
that.
Start to that.
Yeah.
So, like, I've got an argument.
So
everyone sat up like, "Oh, geez, here he goes. He says some stupid stuff sometimes. It's going to be great."
I was so excited for the fight.
I don't fight. Come on. Well, no, and I totally get that, but I don't think most husbands have any clue, like,
yeah,
what
But if they are like, you spend what? I feel like I always get defensive because I'm like, it's always the husbands when they're like, my husband's kind of freaking out about this or whatever. I'm like, they just don't, the difference is they just don't value it.
Well, right. He just bought a pair of Sitka camo pants for $160.
Right.
Like that he'll wear 3 days a year, maybe less. Because he can only wear it in the fall in this area of the country, right?
Yeah.
Because you need like eight different types of camo for different seasons.
Some collect baseball cards. Some there's get merman tails made.
Shoes. We have a shoe problem, Andrew and I.
Yeah.
And so it's all about value, 100%.
Yeah.
And so, and it's like, well, do you want your wife to stay looking young and hot? Like, help them take care of their skin. Like, that's a win-win, right?
Yeah.
So, and I think dudes do need to value a little bit more. I think that maybe we just don't know how to go about it because we have our stupid like Dove men care line and Target. Like, but I think there's like dudes are wearing Lululemon now.
Yeah.
Right.
I didn't know that that was a thing. And then I was just.
Oh, yeah. Like, so I think aware of that. I think skincare like in the Lululemon. Men's world, like I bet that's a market you're going to see like. Shooting up.
That's why I'm like this over explainer because I'm not someone who's like, it's awesome. It's going to make your skin feel fabulous. Like,
right.
Okay.
You like, get into the nitty gritty of it.
Instead, I'm going to qualify what makes that worth it, what you can expect, why this is like, ask me, like, I don't, you know, Susan always says I'm an over informer, but which is true. But like, as far as they want to know, I can satisfy that concern or curiosity. Like,
right. Well, for me, I guess, like, my gut reaction before talking to you and listening to the scientist, skin boss, Dr. Lisa,
Lisa.
Like skincare was like, I always just like acne, you know, like if you don't have acne, then you're fine. You don't need to do it. Like, you don't need to do anything, right? Like you don't have zits, you don't have acne, you're good.
Right. But that's true. That's usually.
You are such a dumbass.
But that's what.
Thanks. You don't even.
We do so much acne because you know the difference is acne, people see more of a need and people come out of desperation for acne. So they're like, I don't care what it's going to take. You clear this out of my skin, you know?
Yep.
But other things, it starts to feel frivolous, you know? So acne doesn't feel frivolous. So there's, it's easier to come to with that. But also I was really like, I was having out with another man the other day. Cause I was like, here's the difference. Men don't age the same as women. So like what your experience, like the joke is like men can wash their face with the same bar they use on their butt and their skin will be glowing and women have a 7-step routine.
I have not used a bar of soap for a long time.
Well, whatever you use, it's like you men know what I mean? Put,
but you're right.
No
I just like
effort.
Squirt the Dove soap into my,
it's not like minimal effort. And minimal struggles.
Right.
Whereas females, like, riding the hormonal roller coaster, like, and when they have, like, adult female acne, these are, like, epidemics because they're getting, like, pigment mustaches because they had a baby. Like, did they ask for this? Like, everything they're getting, like, perimenopausal acne, they're getting all these things. But then also how you age, like, women masculinize as they age. That's cool. Or we all do. Cool for men, not cool for women.
Right.
And do you know what men would be like? Like, so around menopause, like women's estrogen drops so dramatically. And so the volume in your skin drops like you. So you look like a deflated balloon. Like
that's when the beards come.
Like, yeah, that too. So it starts to happen like overnight. Men never experience like a dramatic hormonal change like that. Like, can you imagine what men would be doing if like at age 40, they dropped half their testosterone? Like they'd be like, it'd be a crisis.
Yeah. There'd be lots of testosterone shots happening.
Right? But in the so men just like ride easy for a long time.
Right.
And women are like subject to all this change over and over. And we don't come out looking like really great for it.
Yeah. That's
so it's a little more like
God has some questions to answer.
Justified effort. Justified skincare.
For sure. I think any husband that doesn't. Because we don't have to put our bodies don't go through all that stuff.
No.
Like, which,
thank you. Thank heavens.
But, like, yeah, it's, that's a great, you bring up a great point. It's not just about, like, being girly and wanting to have a certain skin. It's, I until you said that, I've never really thought about that. Like, the hormones.
That's the majority age, like, of what we get.
Having kids, like, yeah, that's
we don't really have like women walk in who have just genetically amazing skin go, what should I do? We have like 90-something% are like, this and this happened because of this. And I'd say 50% of women were looking at their charts. It's like after I had kids,
right.
Yeah. And their skin, and it's legitimate. Their skin changes. Our skin's subject to stress, like changes it, everything. So what else is on
having
the forms?
Kids,
is
like really
medical.
The pros outweigh the cons. I mean, that's a tough one, right? Like, it's hard. Like, they're expensive. They're a real pain sometimes. Like, the dynamic of marriage changes. The dynamic of your body changes. Like, they are taxing little bastards. I guess we get tax breaks from them in some spots. But yeah, like, it's tough. That's absolutely really interesting. So, like, because I'm sure you're always like innovating and think of new ideas. Like, where do men fall into that? Like, is that something you guys talk about in your business plan? Like,
trying
to get more men involved in skincare or get into it?
I like everything to kind of grow naturally. Like I say, I don't want to like force people, and I want people who feel.
Do you want like me and Cam to be poster child?
Yes, I do. No,
no,
but
I do. Like,
but like
being in a restaurant, like
I want to go do
all
it.
The smoke and the grease, like. I really care about it now. I just don't know what to do.
About it. I'm like, it's for everyone. Like, whatever. I'm like, it's for everyone. Everyone has something where if we sit down and talk about it, I'm like, I know I could like break this apart. And you've got something where it's like, oh, well, actually, when I like my skin does this, or I get a little red from this, or I get like, there's needs. Men are usually just simpler. We just don't have like, which is nice. We don't have like the hormonal roller coaster and chaos to deal with. And I'm like, oh, that's so much easier. Like, you don't see men your age, don't break out. Like, rarely. Men deal with breakouts one time during one major hormonal change. And, like, really? It's such a big deal, you know? I'm like, oh, women. So when I have to talk to women, I'm like, we need a long-term plan because you're going to deal with this the rest of your life.
Right.
Like, well, I can't say the rest of your life.
Could you do, like, a date night consultation thing? Like, where they, like, you come in with your wife and you both, like, it's happening?
Perhaps.
A couple's consultation?
Almost, yeah. Almost like a couple's
massage.
It changes
the dynamic. We've had a couple instances where it's not positive when the man is there too.
Okay.
So it depends on the personality.
Just
so,
like an ego thing, like he has to be
that,
like,
or they're like slightly inappropriate, or like so. But that's why it's like any man dares tread on that, like get me in the room, because I was like, you put me on them, like no one's gonna. Yeah. So sometimes that's why I'm like, I treat men right, but when I'm like. Yeah, nothing like feeling some power over them when you're like,
isn't that
oh, that
funny?
Hurts? I'm sorry. Like,
oh no, we're such babies with that stuff. I've had a facial before. It hurt like hell. My eyes were watering.
We need a camera to show you the difference of how men and women react. I will have a 6-year-old woman.
Men are pansies.
And any treatment I do on them, I'm like, can you feel a pain with that? And they're like, it's fine. And I'm like, did you have your babies naturally? And they're like, uh-huh. And then I do this guy, this one treatment where we zap off like little like imperfections on the skin. He jumps up and goes, mother! And he goes, do you hate men? And I was like, what the heck? Just calm down. Like men are always like, ooh. And then we had a man come in last week and he told
me
we did extractions because he wanted blackheads gone. He's like, that freaking hurt. And I'm like, we do it all the time. Like, it's funny. Men are.
Maybe I'm kind of scared.
We're pansies.
Maybe I'm kind of scared
seen the
to go in.
Full YouTube video?
Oh, I know that. Yeah.
Like, it's the best.
Yeah.
Like, Laura. Laura, ringing the bell. But what about
me?
We have
a man with a hurdy leg.
Yeah. No, it's true. I have had, I think, two facials before, and I do remember like some little thing.
They don't all
it,
have to be painful.
It hurt, but I also know, like, see, for me, like, I don't know why, but like bags under my eyes and stuff, like that's what I want to stop.
It's real, there's stuff.
Like that's the thing I'm self-conscious
about. Can you solve
about.
That?
It depends how far you want to go with it. And some things, truthfully, no, because like fat pad shifting in the face, loss of fat, dynamic muscle movement. So unless someone gets Botox, you're not going to erase every wrinkle because we reinforce it over and over that you like make a crease in the muscle.
Yeah.
So, right. But there's like so much you can do. So that's what I was telling my husband. I was like, you should probably start retinol. But I was like, but I need you to wear sunscreen. He's just like not as interested.
See, sunscreen's a big one.
Yeah, so I get him to wear sunscreen.
I never wear sunscreen.
And I make it easy for him. I give him a salicylic cleanser to deep clean because I like that clean feeling. I give him that cleanser and I put it in the shower and say, use that. And then if he has any little blemish pop up because his hat was on his head or something. But I put a little benzoyl peroxide, like, so I take care of everything. But, you know, but I was like, I'd like if we could up this game. I was like, because you're going to start looking a lot older than me.
But, yeah. So I was that stupid. Remember that face app that everybody was doing when China was spying on us? Like, dude, I still look at the old picture of me. The thing that stood out the most were my eye, like the wrinkles around my eyes, and like you could, like, I looked in the mirror, I'm like, I can already kind of see those. So I think ever since then, I'm like, I gotta start, like, I gotta get this under control.
If you want to know how you age, look at your parent. Like, sometimes our faces are a little genetically different. Parent or grandparent, we have genetic, like, wrinkle patterns. So, like, I know, like, I'm not prone to the lines people get here because my mom doesn't have them.
Right.
She has one here and I'm prone to that. And I'm like, no. And we're like, we're prone to sagging. So I'm like, we're going to get all this up there.
That's funny.
So I just look at, there's just the genetics of.
Well, and that's the thing, like, where you're doing nothing, like where I'm doing nothing other than just washing my face with that, like,
you're probably doing
stuff.
More than what most guys do, though.
Well, and maybe, but that's the thing. I think if you almost wonder, like, so with men, could you build like a starter package? Like, this will benefit every man, no matter what.
But I don't do anything cookie cutter, so I will never
do that.
This is the man's package. But in fact, it's on Instagram stories today. I do have three recommendations I love in male skincare.
Huh.
So I can never commit to. This was what every man should do because I'm like, but everyone's
just
different.
Just to get them, like, to dip their toes in the water.
Yeah, so that's what we'll say. Like, I'll say average. I want men to use, they'll like this sunscreen, this cleanser, and this. Like, I already know the sunscreen that is for every man because you won't feel it.
What is it?
It's called Marini Physical Protected Untinted because men don't want tinted because it looks like makeup if it's tinted. So it's untinted, but it's a physical protectant. So it's not, doesn't feel like silky lotion, because if it's silky, they're like, oh, it's female. So it just is simple, but
what?
They don't like the luxurious feel sometimes.
No, I want that.
Okay, I'm gonna give you luxury.
I want, like, why wouldn't you want
no
that?
No, I'm not, but see, it's not like I'm gonna give you stuff that feels like crap. Like,
maybe it's because I'm this big, like, I don't have to, like, prove my man.
Oh, that's, you know what I mean? Like, my husband, I tell him, you look very, like, even
I'm
though
6'5".
He wears fur and stuff, like, yeah. I was
sequin,
like, when you're very masculine
tails.
Looking, you don't feel like you have to prove, like,
yeah, I'm 6'5", like 385. I drive a big truck, like, I don't have to really worry about it. And maybe that's part of it, but yeah, like,
so dive in.
Yeah, my wife gave me this stuff to put on my face the other day. I was like, I kept doing this with my fingers, like, it's like, this stuff feels awesome.
Okay, I'm gonna get you some stuff if you think you don't like
we're
sunscreen.
We're doing a nitty gritty spa day.
Let's. Yeah. I want to. Let's do I this. Totally do. Like. It does have to be easy.
Yeah.
But I'm into it. Like, I would spend money getting good stuff. But yeah, like, I think more dudes would get into it than you think. But I think that if you make it like kind of a package deal for them to start, maybe
this
that'd be hard
good.
For
no,
you.
No, I like it.
With
no,
cookie
I like
cutter
it.
Thing, but
no.
Or even
I think
just everyone
it's three
it's
really
about
easy
everything was a package.
Yeah, and I think with dudes, like, if it was just easy, like, here's step 1, 2, 3, but then something in there, like, do this for a month. If you like it, we can go deeper and get even more results. Because I also think men are about results, right?
Yeah.
And so, I don't know.
What results would you want to see? Because, like, if you were to ask me right now, I don't know that I would, like, have, like, I don't know that I would say, oh, I want this or
so
that.
Well, maybe you don't have something obvious that you're like, I want to improve this for you. You're going to see, like, texture. And if we got more hydration in your skin, like, texture and hydration, you'll be like, my skin just looks a little nicer. And that's the difference of when people just kind of look at your skin and go, like, it's the details. Like, what, when you taste meat and you're like, they took their time on this.
Yeah.
They started with quality beef versus, so you look at someone's skin, it's like, it just looks healthier. Most people call that glow,
like,
but yeah.
When, like, you look at pictures of you on your account, like, that's first thing both my daughter and my wife said, like, oh, she looks like the skin boss. Her skin's amazing. But you know what I mean? Like, maybe in pictures you notice it, right? Like, we take pictures.
But,
with
like, what
guests.
Would you want to do?
You're like, in person.
No, like, for me, like, I just feel like there's some days, like, I can really see.
Yeah, like, I've got an eye gel for you that helps. Because, see, you don't have, I can already tell, you don't have, like, when people have heavy bags, their fat deposits, only surgery gets rid of those because they're like suspended. You can't do anything about that, but you don't have that. So it's like, there's, If it's dark, we have leaky blood vessels. We have hydration, circulation. So I have an eye gel that brightens, and it's got some retinol, so it's build that tissue, because this is the thinnest tissue of skin on your whole body.
For sure. See, I don't really care about the wrinkles on my forehead. Like,
yeah,
I just, but yeah, like some days I'll look in the mirror just when I'm like brushing my teeth. I'm like, I just look tired and beat up. You know what I mean? Like pores look bigger.
That's the thing people say is like, I just look tired. We want to like bring life back to all of it.
Just kind
of
want to brighten it up. I don't know. So it's, and maybe it's just cause I'm 42, like I'm starting to notice it, but yeah, I'm into it. But it, I mean, it still has to be.
Spa day, guys.
Easy. But yeah, let's do it. I think it'd be really cool to talk about it. Like,
no, I have one. I wanted males so that for the purpose of that other males understand, like we've put them in the feed a couple times, but like that they understand this is for you. The same way sometimes I'm like, I need a relatively older female in the feed. So I try not to get like 20-year-olds because I'm like, I don't want people to think that's our, like, oh, we just do young girls who already have no concerns.
Right.
Like, I want them to see, like, no, you belong here. So I want people to see men, but I also don't want it, like, forced where, like, once Susan FaceTimes with some guy and she's like, do you want to do skincare with Lisa? And he's like, what?
I want to do it.
You say yes. You say yes with Susan.
Come in.
I want
to
do it.
No, like, I would pay. Like, that's the thing. Like, I was going to talk to you after.
We're not doing it for free.
I want to go in.
For sure.
Like, yeah, okay, we're going to do skincare.
Yeah.
But yeah, we'll be good because we can talk about it. And
yep.
Like, we'd be good test subjects because we actually want to come in.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, I can't wait. When are we doing this? Tomorrow?
We're going to do this.
Can't wait. Okay. I'm buying that sunscreen too. What's that stuff called? I'm going to start wearing
I'm
right
debating
now.
On if you want a luxurious fill, I might get you something else.
Really?
Yeah.
I'm all about
it. I'm going to get you something. You can
I'm
try
sensory
that.
Overload. Like, that's the thing. I want things that.
Okay.
And I have one you'll like.
There's no sense. It has an oil capture system.
Hey, listen, if you got some coconut smelling stuff,
no.
I'm good with that. That's okay.
Like, you don't want that?
No. I mean, that's just like,
I don't mind scents, is what I'm saying.
Okay. We have things that smell great, but we have other things that have no fragrance so that, you know, doesn't bother any.
See, these dudes are just fronting. Like,
these dudes are just
like, they just grew up with some like hard ass dad and they feel like,
yeah, that's
like,
it.
Give me a break. Come on. I think wearing Lululemons is way more feminine than doing skincare. Don't you think? Or at least like equal.
You
like,
know why?
I don't know why.
No, there's nothing wrong with that. That's what I'm saying. Like, I think if you're wearing Lululemons, you should have no issues with doing skincare.
You know, skincare now, what it's becoming, if you look at like markets like LA and New York, every type of male do skincare.
Right.
Like,
see,
because,
that would scare me more.
Because you
than
know why, though, is now skincare, like, I'm for a skin health perspective, but now it's a status thing. So, like, before it's like, if you want to be manly man, you have a truck, but now, like, you have a Tesla and you're like, I'm successful, you know? So, like, when men do skincare now, they're saying, like, I have the time and money and I look good. Like,
interesting.
So
it's kind of like going to a barber.
It's a status thing to say, I operate and take care at a higher level.
Right.
You know?
See, the problem is my face is going to look amazing. Like, so when are you going to lose weight, though? Do you care about the other stuff? I'm like, please. What? No, but it's true. Like, I just look tired. Like,
you don't see these bags?
I notice it. I don't know what it is, but lately I've noticed it. Maybe it is just an age thing, but I'm into it.
Yeah.
I want to learn.
Okay.
Like, it can't be too crazy.
No. Promise you.
But yeah, I think, and the sunscreen thing is huge. Because I think so many people don't wear sunscreen.
So many don't wear sun, and not sure, not no. daily.
Right. Yeah, and you're wearing it just like if you're in the car and you know the sun.
That's why we put it in the daily routine, so you don't have to think about it.
Does that like replace a lotion, or do you do lotion and sunscreen?
It depends on your skin and what products we've chosen. So it can. I mean.
See, I feel like we have to have a follow up. Like, we need to go.
Yeah.
And then you and Abe need to come back together. Yeah. And, no, because I feel like it's been really cool talking about skin. But I have a feeling we have missed a whole lot about
her and the business,
the story, right? Sure. So I think we should do a Skin Boss number 2.
Okay.
And bring Abe in here.
I love Abe's.
And it will be a couple, like, we'll go do the spa thing. Then we can talk about that too.
Yeah.
Would you be willing to do that?
Oh, 100%.
It'd be so fun.
That'd be awesome.
Because, we've been going for a while.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So where can everyone find you?
Instagram, Facebook is @skin.boss. My website, skinboss.care. I think that covers
so
it.
So did you not have to, you got SkinBoss, the website? You didn't have to deal with anything with that?
I have SkinBoss.care. I have, in fact, after I go back to the spa, I have another call with my lawyer because we've got like issues with, I just rebranded my SkinBoss line to something else. Because we've got someone, so I got the trademark to SkinBoss for the spa, for the product, for the service, like all the things we do. And then someone sent me a thing saying they have it. And so my lawyer looks at it. They started using it first, but they didn't pay to finish the process. So they want me to erase SkinBoss from everything. And I'm like, not going down without a fight.
Heck yeah.
But also I'm like, their company isn't SkinBoss. They made a product for dry cracked heels. They named SkinBoss. And I'm like, that is not.
Let me do you a favor and take the name away because that's not going to do anything for you.
So, we might, I might have minor tweaks in the future, but you can call me whatever you want. Call me SkinBoss.
Dr. Lisa.
I like Dr. Lisa because it is. You're basically a doctor. I mean, you're a dermatologist.
Oh, enough. In another life, I would have done that. But then also I'd be just like cutting skin cancer.
You'd be so boring.
It would pigeonhole you too.
It's not to say
much,
derms
aren't
doing their job. They're broad. They have to do everything from like moles to cancers to warts.
An inch deep and a mile wide.
Yeah. They do so much. And so we're like just specialized. Like I don't have the rights they do, but we're specialized. But I have a medical director, so I can do a lot.
That's awesome.
So
do you have anything else? I had like, so is there a part of what you're doing that you are like most stoked about right now? Or maybe something in the future? Mm-hmm. Like, is there something that's like really like.
Well, honestly, it's just like I'm more now I finally opened up to this idea of like possibilities because I'm the reluctant entrepreneur. I'm not like, I've always wanted to own my own business for a decade. I said, nope. Everyone said, are you gonna own your business? Nope. I don't want to be a slave to it. Well, joke's on me because I am. So,
but do you still get scared? Like when you launch something new? Like,
well, so I've just been so like treading like neck deep in this. And I do like every end of everything that I just hired two more people to take on more. Like I hired one of them's an operations manager. And so I need someone to do so much more of the back end because I'm doing clients. I'm doing back end. I'm doing training. I'm like last night I'm shipping in the shipping room till 10:30. I'm doing like, I'm jumping everywhere because if anyone takes off time, I'm jumping in. So I like, and then to try and balance like a personal home life with that is like, it's draining. Gosh. So I'm stoked now because I have people who are going to start helping me. So I'm like, oh my gosh, I might have a day off in the future. Like I might get a day off or like now. So I looked at Susan and I said, I want to build. And she's like, finally, because forever I'm always like, I don't have to have an empire, Susan. Like, like I just felt so
funny.
Resistant.
That's how I answer the expansion question too.
Yeah. I'm always like resistant. Yeah. Well, people always ask me, you want to own another spot? No. Like, cause like managing like quality control on that kind
for
of
sure.
stuff. Like it's, the reason reluctant entrepreneur, the reason I did it is because it came to the point of this is the only way you're going to have things the way you want.
Yeah.
It's control. Like, right. So it's like I get to a point of if I want things the way I want them, I have to do it myself.
So what would you have changed? Like being reluctant? Do you wish you could go back
no,
and not
because
be reluctant?
I needed all that time to slowly like get to every point I did. So I needed like I did things in a slow pace or I did like, well, we had rapid growth, but like, I mean, I started the consults. It got me so familiar with all and then like perfecting our processes, seeing new needs and just like growing and evolving in a natural way according to the needs. So I wouldn't change my timeline like, oh, I should have jumped in sooner. It's like, yeah, maybe if I would have started social media a few years earlier, I could have grown bigger. But like in the end, I always feel like
well, it happened the way it was supposed to happen.
Yeah, it's great.
Yeah, for sure.
What an awesome. Yeah, we need more of this story. So we're going to do this. We're going to do
facial
spa day and then follow up.
Love it.
With Merman.
I can't
sitting
wait.
In that chair.
Love it.
Right, thanks so much for coming.
Thank you very much.